Hi, my name is Tracy Rice, and I'm a glass and metal artisan from Wisconsin Rapids, Wisconsin. What I'm going to do today is I'll show you some of the things that I do to create some of my work, fused glass, and even a little bit with stained glass. And so what we'll start with is fused glass. Now, people have an idea with glass that you either are going to be blowing glass, which means that you're heating a mass of glass up and then actually blowing into it with a tube and then shaping it with tools. I don't do that. What I do is I take and cut glass and form glass, and then the kiln fuses the pieces together. Now I can manipulate that shape in the kiln and I can make it do different things. But what I do is I'll take and I'll layer. Okay, so with glass, it's all different. So what it has is what's called a coefficient of expansion. So if you've ever seen ice expand and contract in an ice tray, it's kind of like that idea. Glass will heat and cool at different rates. So I can't use any kind of glass. I have to use specific kinds. If I put two different kinds of glass together, what will happen is they will fracture. They will actually crack or possibly even pop. So which in a kiln at about 1480 degrees is not a good thing. So what I'll do is I will take and I will start with a form. So this is a mold, and this is made from porcelain. It's a ceramic. And then I will take that, to get the form correctly, I'll take and I'll trace that. I'll cut these out by hand, using hand tools. And then those forms will get stacked together. And then these forms will get fused. Now it takes multiple firings, it takes multiple fusings and slumpings and a kiln. So that stack, and here's a three stack, for example, that'll be coasters. This, once it's cut, put into the kiln and fused, then that form gets slumped. It gets turned into the form that I want. And glass is an interesting thing. Glass will reflect or it will transmit. You know transmit because if you're riding in a car or if you're looking at your house window, that's light transmitting through. Reflecting is kind of like a mirror. Where it reflects off an image. It's reflecting light. So, for example, with this bowl here, holding up to the light here, you can see it transmitting light through, and detail that isn't very obvious when it's just like this becomes very obvious when light goes through. Now, the idea for reflecting is this. So this is light reflecting off. It hits and we see certain colors. Now this will still transmit some light and give more detail, but this one isn't intended to do that as much as the others. Now, one of the interesting things with glass is that it can be coated. And so where this is just straight glass, this piece here actually has three layers, and the middle layer is a reflective iridescent coating. So it's got a little bit of a shine to it, a little sheen to it down inside. And by layering glass, I can make it do different sheens, different shines. I can make it do different things. One of the other really interesting things that glass can do is have a coating on that's called dichroic. And with dichroic, what you can imagine is if you took a whole lot of crystals and the light reflecting off of the tips of the crystals, let's say they're stacked up, that's going to give you one look. When these are fused though, when these are heated and fused, what will happen is light can actually hit in between all those different crystals, and that becomes a secondary color, or sometimes three or four. So when you're looking at a piece, the colors that are happening because it's not just hitting the surface, it's actually working its way in. Dichroic is interesting because NASA developed this as a replacement for 24 karat gold that was used on the original Apollo missions. So if you can imagine going out past the clouds, a massive amount of sunlight, the astronauts would have gone blind. They coated their face shield to 24 karat gold. Well, that's pricey. So NASA actually developed dichroic coatings to coat onto the windshield and the helmets for the space shuttle missions. So we can get a hold of these things. And we wound up getting the coatings, we can do a lot of things with them. A pattern can even be made with them. and we can lay them down in certain layers and certain colors and certain patterns. So it's not just a flat sheet. So there's a general bit on fusing. So what I'll do now is I'll show how glass is cut and how glass is laid. Now with glass, like I said, it's not just in a sheet, it also can be ground up. So what I can do is I can get glass that's made into different forms, different size chunks, all the way down to an exceptionally fine powder. Part of the trick with this though is that glass being glass, if it gets in your lungs, it never comes out. So you do have to be a little bit careful with working with it. If I'm grinding or if I'm using like a powder, I do need to have a face mask and I do use that, but I won't be doing that right now. Now part of this, and let me get, let's go with a blue-green, that'll be a pretty one. One of the other forms that glass will come in is what's called confetti, which is a little tricky to see, but confetti will come in these sheets and I can lay that on as well and that will give me a totally different look. So I can take the glass and depending on how I layer it, that will give me certain looks. So let's show some layering with this. Now this is ground glass. It's a rough ground glass layered on, and I mix it with an organic glue. And once that glue dries, the water evaporates out, it locks together the pieces of glass. And then that can be put into a kiln with other bits attached onto it. And then it will take and fuse into these. Now this is going to be a stand of birch trees. So with my property, I've got quite a few trees out in the woods here. So I'll go out and I'll get photos of the different trees. And then I'll take those and I will layer the glass on. And the way I'll do this to give more depth is you can see these are pretty rough and they're pretty fuzzy. And that's what I want, because I want them to have the illusion of being further away from you. Then what I'll do is I'll take clear. I'll take two more trees, make them crisper and cleaner, a little bit more, and put them on in a different position. Then I'll take another sheet, do at least three layers, and then those other two I'll make very crisp, very clean, and then they'll give you the illusion that you're looking through a stand of trees. But that all starts with the ground glass. So all of these are actually different colors and different textures, so different thicknesses of the glass. Okay. Now, let me show you how simple it is to cut glass. So this is a hand tool. This is like, people have seen glass cutters all the time. This is simply a much more precise, much more exact one that actually has a pivot to it. So I can do scroll work and things with it. But basically, this is very thin glass, so it pops very easily. But that's essentially the same idea to do for any type of glass. And this is going to be a large piece. So this full sheet here, which is 24 inches by 22 inches now, is actually going to be a base sheet for a large piece that I'll do. And I do some smaller ones, I do some larger ones. It just depends on what I feel like doing. But to take and to do a tight corner, let me go ahead and I'll do this one very quickly. This, as you can see, this mold and this glass have got rounded corners. So I can cut them. I can also take them, and using a special pair of pliers that have a very specific jaw on them, I can take and actually grind the corners so that they're rounded. Okay. And then everything that I do, all the little bits, even the little bits here, in this special tray, I'll collect all those and I'll reuse that. So all of my shards, all of my bits, everything that gets cut off, I can use that. And actually I do different forms with those. And even, it's a little tricky to see, but even the chunk powder, the stuff I just nibbled off, I'll keep that and I can use that. So, okay. So what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna go ahead and cut a form for a bowl. So this will be like one of the large bowls that I showed earlier. And this cut, this piece here I've already cut. So this was out of a full sheet. And what I'll do is I'll take, and I'll get my glass in 4x4 foot sheets, like that large clear one that you saw before, and I'll cut them down into different sizes. So this is a 12x12 square, which is what the same size as this blue with the cloud effect. And so this is my glass cutter, my circle cutter. So I'll put these pieces in and I'll adjust the size. And I can't quite go all the way out to a full 12 inch. Glass, when it fuses, when it slumps a little bit in the kiln, what that means is that it actually will flow out. It reaches a homeostasis, it reaches a balance. So that will normally be up to about a quarter inch on two and especially three layers of this kind of thickness of glass. And it's about 1/8 of an inch thick. So what I have to do is I have to take that into account. So it's not so much a matter of the disc being so large, because I have a kiln that has a 13x13 shelf on it, easily can handle this size, but my big kiln actually is 24 inches by 39 inches. So I can easily handle multiple 12 inch discs, but my molds are limited. So my mold is limited to just, the width of the mold is just over 12 1/4 inches to allow that little extra bit. So I have to make sure that when I'm setting this, I don't set it all the way out, because it'll actually be a little too large. So what I'll do is I will set this up and I just double check it just to make sure it's in the right spots. And with people, they'll hear, if you ever watch someone do glass, and everyone's different, it's like being a painter, it's like being a potter, everyone's a little different. My original background was actually in metals. Originally I went to college for painting and drawing. I was trained in how to be a painter, actually in high school in Chicago. And went to a high school that you actually could major, so I majored in painting. And so when I went to college, I actually didn't care for how the painting program went, I switched to metals. So my first degree is actually in metals. And then I went from there and started getting into sculpture quite a bit. And glass evolved out of that. So being able to take and do glass work as sculptural pieces, these are actually some of the small ones. Later on, you'll be able to see some of the pieces that I have over at the Central Wisconsin Cultural Center, for example. So I have this set up, and like I said, everyone's a little different. I prefer to use the glass cutter a little differently than it was originally intended. And what comes across as an awful noise actually to me sounds really good, because I know it's doing the job I want it to do. So I take and I score the disc. And now I have to take and cut that disc. And the problem with this, though, is that the excess glass isn't set up. And if I'm not careful, then it can actually fracture across. So what I need to do is I need to put guidelines. So I take my tool, and I just very carefully, very gently put in guidelines. So they're just extra little score lines that help to direct the glass to fracture off a certain way. And then there's one other step. Actually, I'll move these to show that. Yeah, I should move this first. Edit this part out, please. This is why I have this soft pad. Okay, so now we're back to it. So what I'll do is when I take it and I've got this scored, and I've got my little score lines there, then I'll flip this over and making sure that I mark, because every piece of glass is unique, and I'll press on the back. And what that will do There you go. And sometimes it'll take and snap right there for me. So what that's going to do is that's going to take and score my corners for me. Now, I have to be very, very careful with this because doing it this way, I don't really get hurt pressing down, but these edges become literally razors. I mean, they're finer than a razor. And if I'm not careful, I can get sliced up pretty well with these. And that's actually one of the things people always ask me about is, well, don't you get cut? Don't you get hurt doing this? And constantly. I'm always shaving chunks off of me and getting little cuts, and it's just part of the deal. It's part of what happens. When I'm working in the blacksmith shop and I'm doing my metal work, this is me not paying attention closely as I should on my glass, I'll get burned every day, and it's just part of the deal. So, all right. Now with those two not quite wanting to give up the ghost, the other thing I can do is very gently. Tap on the bottom, and then see if they'll release, and if not, I can do it again. No, doesn't want to. Yeah, obviously, if I tap too hard, I'll wind up snapping it. Now, why don't I just go back and recut it again? Because you can't. The cutting wheels that are on any glass cutter, if you go over the same cuts more than once, it actually will start to grind up the metal wheel, and then they won't be as sharp. They won't be as clean. So. And this is just part of the process. Ooh, it's being stubborn today. However much this you want to edit out. All right, let me do this. Why don't you go ahead and... it's digital, doesn't matter. Let me just get this done. This happens sometimes. Where it doesn't quite get up the ghost.
There you go.
So. Right, let me do one last thing with this. Now, sometimes if they don't want to take and go like this doesn't, then what I can do, actually, let me put it over on the table, is I can take and add an additional score line or two and get parts of it off. So if part of it isn't quite giving up, but the other will, then I can take and I can do this. So what I'll normally do is I'll simply cut. There we go. And you can see it actually. You can actually watch it. And it'll pop. You can actually see it crack inside. Now this, yes, it does break every now and then, but not usually. There we go. Okay, so now the chunks that I have left over, what I'll do is I'll simply take my pliers, nibblers here, and I'll simply snap off and nibble off the excess. So it won't be quite a perfect circle in some of those little small spots where I have to nibble, but it does fuse up and clean up really well in the kiln. So it'll smooth out quite a bit, and I get it pretty close. So let me just get this last little bit here, and I'll stack them and you can see it. The difference. There's a reason why I'm using cream with that blue, and there's a certain look that I'm after. And you can influence and push your designs based on how the light, remember, reflecting and transmitting, is going to work together. Okay, So just to get that far, and I still have to be very careful with this because I haven't cleaned up all the edges. So what I'm doing, and I'll show you the difference, get a little kind of an eclipse effect there, and you can see there how this causes a much richer, much deeper color look to put it on top of that cream. If I put this on top of other colors, it actually will darken this up enough to where it looks like a very, very deep, deep blue, almost a black. Or I can brighten it up to where this almost looks like a sky blue. Just depends on how far I want to push it. So there's that effect. Let me set this over here. As I said, taking and layering those, then what that will do is that will give me not only something that's strong enough because it's thick enough, but also something that gives a certain color look to it. And when I have a piece like this, or like these, this is three layers of glass thick. So there's a top, this sort of cloud piece of glass here. So it's a clear with a white streak across it. There's that one. Underneath that, it's a little tricky to see, but underneath that is this blue iridescent that I described earlier. And then on the very bottom is white. Now you notice that on these, I've got clear squares in the bottom. This actually is recycled glass. And this glass came from a greenhouse in Stevens Point that was taken down. And the company that was doing the work, taking it down, had called me knowing that I work in glass and asked if I wanted some. Otherwise, all of it, because they couldn't use it all, unfortunately. They had called to see if I wanted some, so it didn't have to go into a landfill. So I got some of these, and I can reuse them for things like this, just for the feet, just to give a little bit of more of a base, and I happen to like the look of it better. The other thing that I'll do with them is I'll make terrariums out of that glass. So that's part of the other work that I do. And there's two here that just got started, and they're not cleaned up yet. So they're gonna look a little dirty. But this will be a piece of stained glass, and then there's a bevel piece in there, and ignore the markers, the lines that are on it. These straight pieces of glass, these smooth ones, are actually the glass from that greenhouse. So decades old glass, very old glass, and it has a lot of imperfections. It isn't perfectly cleaned up, which is really a nice thing, because this lived. This actually grew things. This glass actually supported life in that greenhouse. And for me, I think it's a fantastic way to take and put it back into something else that's going to take and grow plants. And what that will start off as, here's one of the front panels here. Once again, it's not cleaned. I'll clean the glass. It comes in 25 by 25 sheets. I've got literally just over a ton of it. Clean it, take and tape it, and then take and there's one of the pieces there, and that's actually not a 3, that's W for window glass, so I can tell my glass apart. It looks very close to one of my other clear glasses, and I can't mix the two up. But I'll take and tape them with copper foil tape, which is self-adhesive, and then that gets soldered. And I have to use a lead-based solder, because it's the only thing that will really work and really last, and give me a good strong bond with my pieces. So this, like I say, here's one of the front panels, and I can turn them horizontal or I can turn them vertical. Just depends on which way I want to go with them. And I'll keep them pretty simple. But what I'll put into them is I'll actually put succulents and into them. I'll put in cactus. So it's like a type of cactus is a succulent. And I'll put those in, or I'll put a tropical in, and I'll do them totally separate so people can, depending how much work they want to put into their terrariums. So with that, essentially what happens is that you have your foil, and I'll coat the outside edge of the foil, of the glass. When that gets coated, then I'll put them up against each other. And then using just a heavier duty, but it's just a standard soldering iron, take and put a mild acid solution on them, a flux, and then run the solder on them. And that will make a permanent a permanent bond. Now, stained glass, when I do my stained glass work, I can do tape, and in certain instances, that's actually stronger than leading. So with leading, with stained glass, and here's a couple pieces of stained glass here, just different colors. Nope, there's three actually. To put these together, I don't take and foil them. I'll take and lead them. For my stained glass work, here's a box of some scrap leading and some smaller pieces. So I said that will actually be lead. And so with that, and here's some test pieces that I've done before. So that will literally be laid on and wrapped. And lead is soft. So this is much faster than it normally would go, but to get the idea, not as clean as it normally would be. But that would be it. Then once I reach the end here, I have specialty knives that I'll take and I'll cut these on an angle so they fit together as tightly as possible. Then the next piece will go in right into the groove along with it. And then that will be covered with lead. And so it's each one is individually done. So with the stained glass, when I have individual pieces of glass, I'll take and lay the whole design out, and then each section of it will have to be broken down into smaller pieces. Those will be individually wrapped with the leading, or depending on if it's a very tight, small detail area, I may do that in foil, then that will all be soldered together. So with the leading, it will be wherever I have a junction, wherever I have pieces touching, that's where it'll be soldered. And it has to be soldered on both sides. So when the entire window is done, then the entire thing is flipped over, soldered on the back side, and then that whole thing is cleaned, packed with a special compound to fill the gap, because as tight as these are, there's still a little bit of play. There's always a little bit of play between the glass and the leading. That will get packed in with a special compound to tighten it up, then the whole thing is flipped over again, cleaned, and then that side is packed. And so all of that has to be done before the window can be stood up. So once the window's stood up, which sometimes, depending on the size of the window, it takes multiple people to help stand it up, they're so big and heavy, then the whole thing has to be cleaned, put in place, cleaned again, and it becomes a very long process. But that's what's required to have a window that will last 50, 60, 70 years. Not that long ago, I redid a window for the Sacred Heart Church in Nakusa, and that was a window that was not very large. It was only about 19 by 25, but the church was 81 years old when I got the commission. So to take and remake that window, quite honestly, the glass was just not in good enough shape to reuse the pieces from the window and just simply remake it. I had to recut all the glass from scratch. So this is some of the test pieces that I had done to try and match up shapes and textures and all. One of the other weird things about this with glass, because it's individually made, because everything is unique with glass, people who had made that glass 81 years ago would have their own little recipe book, just like your grandmother would have her recipe book for how glass is done, or excuse me, how her food's done. There's somebody who has that for their glass. And when they retire or die, that knowledge is gone many times. So we don't know how they exactly did it. There's obviously very talented people who know how to work in the glass, but you can never get it exactly the same. So that's probably the difficulty I had with this 81-year window. The glass simply isn't there anymore. So I had to match it and actually get the textures and the colors as close as possible. So, but right now, what I'm working at over at the Central Wisconsin Cultural Center is a 4x8 foot window, stained glass window, for a gentleman named Grim Natwick, who was originally from Rapids, who was an animator. He lived for 100 years, actually, so for 100 years, and was one of the main animators for the 20th century, working for everyone. Did Snow White and Woody Woodpecker and Popeye, Betty Boop, many, many characters. So we're doing a tribute window for him, and some of his characters. So that'll be developed, and that'll be coming along. We'll see that later on. So, with move this, and let's take a look at how these pieces are layered together. Now, with glass, so let's say those full 12-inch sheets that I've cut down from 4x4, actually these were in 2x2 foot sheets, and I cut them down to 1 foot, and then I'll cut strips off. And the strips for these I want intentionally because I'm looking for certain patterns. I'm looking for certain color forms. And you can see with these four, they're different. These two are fairly similar, but all four are actually pretty different. So I'll use these in different ways. And one of the things that I'll do with them is I'll cut leaf forms out of them. And with those leaf forms, depending on how I want, there's a different one. Depending on how I want these to go, I'll take and I'll use different ones. So if I'm doing a bowl and I want to be able to take, or a wall piece or something, and I want to be able to have a certain color in it to match the background, I'll pick different ones of these and then I'll get different effects. So I may use ones like these quite a bit where there's a lot of variance and very intense colors, or I may use softer tones if the background color is very dark and intense. Just depends on what I want to use for. So, but these will all be laid in. I do not glue these. When I'm doing my bowls and my dishes and things like that, I don't bother to glue them. I set them up and then I'll take them and put them directly into the kiln just like that. It's different than the Frit paintings. The ground glass is called Frit. It's different from that. So that needs to be glued. So because that is so small, it'll shift all over the place and I'll lose my design. So, take a quick look at that and what gets involved in that process. Okay. So right now, actually, you never want to walk in my shop barefoot. I don't vacuum that often, so you don't want to walk in my shop barefoot. All right. So right now, I said I've got this one that I've already done. It's already been fused. It has a clear sheet that was laid on top. So the Frit was put on, the detailing was put on, and then a clear sheet was laid on top of it before it was fused, to get that extra layer in there. So this piece of glass right here, including the Frit, is actually three layers deep. So it has a nice textured green back sheet. That's got a nice translucence to it. So that one will get a little bit of life coming through, a little bit of green coming through it. But the glass that I'm putting on it, this Frit, is actually opaque. So it's where this is a translucent. So the more of this idea, the Frit that I'm putting on is actually solid. No light will go through it, which is what I want. I want the trees to look solid, and I want the background to be the illusion of it going back and there being more depth, which you get from being translucent. So I have the clear sheets. I have my glue that I use is what's called methyl cellulose. So it's a food additive, actually. It's a thickener. So this I'll take and I'll simply put this in with my Frit. Too much, it flows all over. Too little, it doesn't do anything. So I know it looks like I'm just sort of hodgepodging this, but you kind of get used to how much and how little and how it'll all work. And with tools for what I lay my Frit down with, basically it's like every painter, it's like when I was painting, it's like when I'm doing the metal work, you make your own tools. This fib right here, this is actually something for taking and doing stained glass work. And for me, it makes a nice little shovel. It makes a nice little bit to pick up the frit. And this little pick right here is what I'll use to take and lay it down. And then this little cheap paintbrush actually works great with this other end to take and shift and move it. And you get a feel for this stuff. Your hands will start to do things that you don't even realize you're doing. When I would draw, people would say, well, why are you turning the pencil when you draw? And I never even realized I was doing it, to get a finer tip, to get, you know, get more of an exact edge. Your glass, if you decide to do this, you will eventually find a way, and you have to be patient with it. You have to make sure that you give yourself time to work this out, because your hands will figure out a way to do it that you may not, like I said, be aware of. The other tool that I have here is, and it's really hard to see, but this coil on the bottom has a ball that has a very tiny hole in it. And so it has a spring here. And so what I'll do is I'll load this up with fine powder or fine grit glass, and then rubbing along, and I found this actually, this little pair of pliers are the best thing I found for it. And what that will do is that will vibrate this and cause this to come out in a very exact, very controlled way. So if I need to do lines or dots or things like that, I can do it with this, or I can do it with these. So you'll figure all these little things out and find these little tools and all these little bits, and it'll work out just fine. So what I'll do is I'll take and I'll select a couple of trees, and why don't I just do those two right there, just make it easy. I'll take some of the frit up and I'll just simply set it down. And sometimes I'll work with a drawing. Actually, a lot of times, if it's a very detailed piece, I'll work with a drawing. I'll actually draw on the glass. And I'll just use a Sharpie marker, you know, a fine line Sharpie marker or something like that. And the marker will burn off most of the time in the kiln. So I have to be careful with that. If it gets trapped between two layers of glass, it may not burn out. So you always want to make sure that you're watching what you're doing with that. But then what I'll do is I'll simply take and, starting from wherever I like, and once again, trying to give the illusion of depth with this, I'm making sure that these are shifted off differently than the ones that are already on there. So I'm not concerned about exactly where these two are, since I have two panels that I can work with. And that's normally what I'll do. If I'm doing a piece like this, I'll make sure I have multiples. So I usually only do three of anything. I quite honestly get bored and I want to make sure that things are a little more unique, a little more exclusive. But I'll take and I will set that up in a way that it doesn't matter which way it goes. And I'm not concerned about how regular and straight up and down and exact this is. It's a tree. It shouldn't be straight up and down and exact. In its whole lifetime, all the decades that it lives, things will happen to it. It'll shift and move. So let it do that. Let the frit do that. So there's that. And then I'll just simply keep adding it on. And then just laying it down. Now, this is a pretty simple form. Some of the more complex things, it'll take a bit more work, or I may have to do multiple touches with it. Like right now, it's a little too much methyl cell. It's not a big deal. I'll let this dry up some, let that evaporate a little bit, and then I'll go back and I'll readjust it. Never leave it till it's dry. And then these, with the ends of them, since they have that on there, I just rinse them off. That's it, and they're ready to use again. Same thing with the fib here. So that's the start up here. Now I said, no, there'll be this one will go up, next one will go up, and when it's done, it'll be this idea here. So that's the same frit, the same color, same texture, you know, that one's done. So now what I'll do, let's move this one out of the way. Is now I'll go back in and I'll start adding details. So I'm gonna move this up closer. And as I said, these are gonna be the back ones, so they're gonna be fuzzier like this original one was. So I'm not concerned about getting everything just crisp, perfect, all that. So what I'll do is, actually, let's go with this. I'll just do these two here. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to take some black, start with this edge. Oh, and I'm getting older, so when I'm doing detail work, I take my glasses off. bifocals never seem to, actually those are trifocals, they never seem to work for me. So I gotta take them off. The things that happen when you get older. So I'll start to lay these in. And once again, I'm not wanting to be an exact, clean, crisp edge. So I'll lay that in, go back, and take my tool. So when I do want it on the edge, and I want a nice, irregular, nice, dark shadow line. And that's about it. So there's that black edge there. And all the little bits and everything, just get rid of those, don't need that. And once I get all the black laid in, then I'll go back and add the other colors in. Now it depends on, sometimes I work light to dark, sometimes I work, you know, dark to light. This I'm going to be working dark to light because with the birch trees, once I have that initial color down, for me, when I look at them, I'm seeing very dark edges, but most of it is shades of gray, which is where I'll have in the trays here, I'll have my various colors of white, and I'll have other trays, and each tray, and it's just egg carton trays, you know, just styrofoam egg carton trays, which great way to reuse the things instead of putting them in the landfill. I'll put the same color, but two different textures. So a fine and a medium in each color. Most trays I'll have will be like that. Sometimes I just want a color grouping, so I'll simply put a color grouping in, and then this is just different ones. This is that very fine powder that I just have for certain uses here. And then with my Fritz, because it's ground glass, and you saw earlier I was taking it, I'll use the chunks, I'll use the powders and all, I can make my own Fritz. I'll buy it already made up, which works 90% of the time or so. I mean, it works almost all the time, but there's just certain colors that I want to have. Like for example, for glass, gold is actually what makes the purples and the reds. So when you see a red tint of some kind, purple, pink especially, reds, that's made with gold. And sometimes it's very, very hard to find it, and reds are very expensive comparatively. A 12 by 12 sheet might be 50% more than, you know, with a red than it would be with a yellow or a blue or something like that. So when you're trying to get Frit, sometimes you just can't find it. So that's where I keep all the stuff. You know, if they came in here, they think, oh, it was crazy because there's containers of little chunky bits all over the place collected up, because I can take that and I can grind that up and I can make my own colors from it. So, now the one other thing on the glass that I mentioned earlier, there is different types of glass. They all have a different coefficient of expansion, like I mentioned before. 96 is what I work with. So depending on what the number is, that's going to depend on what type of glass it is as far as how it expands and contracts when it heats and cools. So for example, my wife, who's an art teacher over at Lincoln High School, she uses 90. It's just what she started using. 96 is just what I started using. So it's just what everyone's personal preference until it comes to certain things. This large window that I mentioned, that's the 4x8 one, I'm going to be doing fused panels along with stained glass panels in it. I have to actually be careful to make sure that the glass I'm using is compatible with the Frit. So, and I've got a couple plans for that, so it won't be an issue. But that's a very important thing. If you're going to do glass, make sure whatever you get is the same thing over and over and over again. Otherwise, you're just going to be ruining your pieces and possibly damaging your kiln. 90, a little bit of an older standard, a little bit more available for 90 than there is for 96. I just happened to like 96. I happened to like what it looked like. So that's where I started with it. Personal preference. There's quite a bit more coming out with 96 though, so it really doesn't much matter. It's whatever you like. But when you start getting into things like Pyrex and, you know, the bakeware stuff and all that, totally different than a window glass or a borosilicate is what a Pyrex type of glass is, which is a very, very dense, very intense strength to it. Much stronger than what this is. You know, I've bounced trays and bowls accidentally off the floor. And yeah, you can chip them. Yeah, I can break them. But a lot of times, because this is tempered, it doesn't really hurt it. So, but you can. But it takes a lot once it's done correctly. And when you fire, like one note on firing, when you fire something in a kiln, it has to be a glass kiln. It has to be a kiln that has exacting controls, a digital control on it. Because it's a multi-step, it's a multi-ramp up to your temperature, and then it's a multi-ramp down. My small kiln, my 13 by 13, I can get two firings done a day. In a 24-hour period, if I really am pushing it, I can get two firings done. So you never open a kiln above 100 degrees, but I can get two firings done in a day. My big kiln is a full 24 hours, even the same temperatures, because it's simply a larger kiln. So there's a whole lot of things to learn. There's a whole lot of bit for that. A lot of videos online, a lot of information that you can get. So that's a whole different thing, and you can get into a lot of that. But it's a huge investment, it's a huge time commitment, but you also can get huge rewards from doing this kind of work. So getting into it is a lot, and you have to commit to it. This isn't like you're gonna get a pencil and a little sketch pad and you're gonna doodle every now and then. This is a commitment. This is what I do for my living. This is what my life is. I do glass and metal work. That's what I do. But if you commit to it, it's unbelievable some of the things you can make. The stained glass window work, you know, think of Tiffany lamps, think of Tiffany windows. Think of any glass you've ever seen that you've gone, oh, wow. Well, they all started somewhere. So, good luck.